lifesaver is on. Video is recording.
Tonight, then mostly cloudy, the low 64. It's 79 in Cincinnati. Support for NPR comes from this station and from the Nature Conservancy, partnering with communities across the globe to find solutions to the climate and biodiversity crises, committed to building a future where people and nature can thrive. nature.org/solutions. And from Data IQ, a platform for everyday AI, to help organizations make AI part of their daily business, designed to elevate people, teams, and companies. DATAIKU.com. It's Morning Edition from NPR News. I'm Michelle Martin in Washington, D.C.
Jeremy Martinez in Culver City, California. Rising gun violence has affected communities across America. This past weekend, shootings killed and injured people in cities and rural areas spanning Philadelphia to San Francisco. In Chicago, at least 70 people have been shot over the long holiday weekend. In one incident, one person was killed and 22 others wounded when Juneteenth celebrations turned violent early Sunday at a strip mall parking lot in the suburb of Willowbrook. The White House called the violence a tragedy. Joining us now with more is Sophie Sheeran, reporter for the Chicago Sun-Times. Sophie, how violent was this holiday weekend in and around Chicago?
So in the city of Chicago, at least 70 people were shot, like you said. We believe that number is probably close to about 74 at this point. Sadly, 11 of those people have died, making this the most violent weekend thus far this year and one of the deadliest. Just in the city alone, there were 4 mass shooting incidents where there were more than 4 victims hurt in a single shooting. And as you mentioned, about 20 miles outside of the city, there was a mass shooting at a Juneteenth celebration with 23 people shot, and unfortunately one of those people has died.
And does anyone know what may have led to those shootings?
So police are still investigating that shooting in the suburb of Willowbrook as to what started it. We know this was a Juneteenth celebration, a celebration that had taken place before on the same grounds in years past. There were about 200 people there, but unfortunately, police do not yet know what sparked that shooting hours into the celebration that led to 23 wounded. And this wasn't the only event where people were gathered to celebrate. In Chicago, one of those mass shooting events occurred at what was a Father's Day barbecue in a neighborhood on the south side. And again, police are still looking into what sparked that incident.
I hate to call a tale of the tape when it comes to something as awful as this, but I mean, how does this weekend compare to other weekends? I mean, was this exceedingly violent in comparison?
So far this year, this was exceedingly violent. 73 people shot, or 74 around what we count is right now, would be the most people shot in a single weekend. Obviously, this was a long weekend, so we're including the Monday holiday. The Memorial Day weekend was also one of the most violent since 2016, with 61 people shot here in the city. But unfortunately, obviously, this past weekend, we saw far more shootings than that.
And how are our city leaders trying to tackle this, trying to figure this out?
Mayor Brandon Johnson spoke at an unrelated event and mentioned that this is going to take an all-hands-on-deck effort, that everyone needs to play a part in working to reduce gun violence. And was certain to touch on that this is an issue of disinvestment in neighborhoods that's going to take a lot of work and possibly time to correct.
That's Sophie Sheeran, reporter for the Chicago Sun-Times. Sophie, thanks.
Thanks so much.
We've been talking about the toll of gun violence all over the country, but adding to the toll in Black communities is police violence. Black Americans are 3 times more likely to be the victim of fatal police shootings than white Americans. That according to several studies by public health experts. And now there's a scathing new report by the Department of Justice that found numerous examples of racism and excessive force against Black and Native Americans by the Minneapolis Police Department. The report, which was of course spurred by the police killing of George Floyd in 2020, highlights an issue that goes beyond the Minneapolis department, broken trust between police and people of color. What would change that? Rashad Robinson has been thinking about that for some time. He is president of the social justice organization Color of Change and is with us now. Thanks so much for joining us once again.
Thanks for having me.
So you read the DOJ report about Minneapolis. Just as briefly as you can, initial reactions, anything stand out to you?
Well, it was just a litany of incident after incident, failure, systemic failure after systemic failure. And it just, in so many ways, painted a larger culture of Minneapolis Police Department, but also police departments that we see around the country. I think the Minneapolis report from the federal government is a very clear checkup, but like any doctor's checkup, what happens next will determine how healthy any of this becomes.
What would that look like? What would some meaningful reforms look like? I'm asking you as a person who's obviously been reading reports like this for some time now.
You know, even the most effective consent decrees isn't effective
Come on,
enough
pops.
At tackling
Guess
all the incentives that make law enforcement lawless and sometimes out of control, and make that out of control behavior the norm, as we saw in the Minneapolis report. So we need more tools of concrete oversight and accountability, not just community input, but real oversight from community. We need a new set of incentives. Really in terms of how police departments operate, how police are rewarded. And then we also have to deal with the conditions that actually can make a decree like this work when they come out of a report like this. They oftentimes fail because the right conditions are not present. So police departments, police unions, politicians, they all have a way of undermining them. And if we actually don't deal with that type of status quo, what we saw on paper will be just that, a piece of paper.
A lot has been talked about the fact that, you know, we're in a moment where, as we just heard, there is a lot of violence in the society right now. We can, you know, we don't have time to sort of dig into all the possible reasons why that is. On the one hand, you do have people who are living in fear of street crime and they want to feel safe. On the other hand, people don't want to be victimized by the people who are charged with keeping them safe. Have you, you know, are there places where people are getting that balance right?
I think there are places that are working towards that. And, you know, we work with the Brookings Institute and VERA and to release our vision for public safety. It's on our website at colorofchange.org. And it is a report that really outlines investments, what we should be funding out in the world, like mental health, like violence prevention programs. There's a whole set of programs that have been developed that are working in communities that we're seeing being introduced. We also know that the safest communities in our country are not animated by the number of police officers that they have. They are animated by the type of economic development that they have. They're animated by other supports. And so we do want to really invest in public safety and make our communities more safe, but we actually have to ensure that our budgets become those moral documents, that we're not just investing in policing, but we are investing in safety.
That's Rashad Robinson. He's president of the social justice organization Color of Change. Obviously, Rashad, this is an ongoing conversation, so thanks so much for having it once again with us.
Thanks for having me.
screensaver is on. Video is recording.
Section. Central and Pershing.
Thank you.
Street and Black Street Bridge. Going to check out this neighborhood meeting at the park. Hopefully it's not awkward. I guess it can't hurt. If it's terrible, then I just won't go to the next one. The first one, at least the first one I've heard of, so we're trying to build community and all that. I mean, it's not a bad neighborhood, but it's a lot of working people, so we don't really talk, we just work, come home, do our own thing. Don't talk to each other, so maybe through these neighborhood meetings there's more interaction between neighbors. Less robotic, I guess. Not a soul is here. Well, I'm pretty early, I'm like 25 minutes early. That was a pretty good meeting. Not a huge turnout, I think because of the weather. It's kind of cold. It was wasn't bad. I'll probably go to the next one and participate. And maybe if I play my cards right, get into politics or get a Hamilton City job or something.
The screensaver is on. Video is recording.